Yo, what's good YouTube? This is Jay from TNJ. And leading into All-Star break, we're looking at a couple of games before hopping into a crucial series right before All-Star break. So I mentioned a couple videos ago and last video that our offense just isn't there. And we were floating around the idea of getting a couple of guys and through trades. And we're going to explore that this episode. So you don't want to miss any action. So hit that like button if you want to see more of this action. So this is what I'm talking about. This game went to 11 innings and we scored one run. We won 1-0 versus Atlanta. So you can see right now we're 51-41. Let's look at another game. So then in the third game of the series, this is actually a 2-0 series at this point. This is a third game in a four game series. We get four hits. So you can see we get four hits and we just can't put anything together. As you can see, who's doing well in this game? Nobody. I mean, Brinson goes 0-4, Castro 0-4, Machado 0-3, Santana goes 2-4. He's our lone bright spot and we only get four hits. So let's just look at the next game in this series. So like I said, we were up 2-0, then we lost that game, then we lose another game, only scoring one run. I mean, the runs are just not coming across the plate for us. Brinson goes 0-4 in back-to-back games, and so does Castro. So it's kind of, you know, a bad sign when some of these guys are doing so bad, and we probably need to make a move. Then hopping into the next series, we kind of turn things around, winning 2 out of 3 games versus the Milwaukee Brewers. This one we win 6-1. We did lose the first game in the series 9-10, but then the next game we absolutely destroyed them, 113-5. And in this game, Brinson did go 3-6. Valencia got the start. He goes 2-6. Machado goes 4-6. And Santana actually takes a little break, goes 1-5. So he's hitting 285 at this point. And let's just look at, you know, who's leading our team in hitting, because not a lot of guys are doing well this year at the plate. Jung Ho Kang actually does get hurt in that game. He's down for 1 to 2 weeks. So that's kind of a blow, because look at him. He was hitting 375 with 56 at bats. Now let's keep going on the line. Domingo Santana's hitting 286. No surprise that he's hitting well. I think he's arrived as a star. Manny Machado hitting 271. Going down the line, Justin Bour hitting 270. But if we go down here, look at the two guys at the bottom of the averages here. Leury Garcia only hitting 227. And that's kind of a bad sign, because remember last year he hit 294. He hit 270 the year before that. Then he kind of hit pretty bad down here in probably like a half a season. This season he only had 14 at-bats. But then Real Muto only hitting 226. He's pretty much been the full-time starter, but he's kind of declining a little bit. He is happy because his morale, so he's going up in overall. But let's just look into some trades that we floated around. So I brought up Rusney Castillo, and if you look at his stats here, he has really good attributes. He has really good attributes, but his stats just aren't there. So 170 he hit last year and 153 at bats. But before that, he never really hit above 250. I mean, here he had 36 at bats, but that doesn't count. He hit in a full season almost, he hit 253. So I don't know how much of a help he would be at the MLB level, and just looking to see what they want for him. I mean, they kind of want a lot. I'm not gonna give up Drew Steckenrider, and they want Drew Steckenrider more than anybody in all three trades here. They want him included, and I don't think it's worth giving up Steckenrider for Rusney Castillo, because if you look at what Steckenrider is doing this year in the setup role, he's kind of doing pretty good. 122 whip, 110 ERA, not somebody that I'm willing to give up. But what's interesting is that I actually found somebody who I think is pretty good. The Yankees actually picked up Yero Munoz, and here's the thing. He got traded last year to the Yankees, and he's been kind of productive. I mean, if you look at him, he played 86 games with St. Louis last season, and he actually hit 280 in his rookie year, hitting 271. So that's actually pretty good, to be honest. And if you think about it, if he's at 69 overall right now and his morale doesn't boost him up or down, I think he can potentially probably boost up to about 73 overall or so. And if you look at his attributes, he has decent speed, 72. Arm strength and fielding is actually pretty good, and he's only 24 years old. His vision's high, so he's not going to strike out a lot. And you know what? For a young guy, he actually can hit the ball okay. So I actually think I'm going to make a deal for him, and especially since he's 24, we don't know if he's going to be the future of our outfield. Obviously, we have Hooks Jr. coming up into the system next season. We have Aguilla, but Aguilla does need to work on his arm strength, because I cannot put him at the major league level if he has arm strength at 42. He has gone up to plus three already, so hopefully that keeps progressing. Monty Harrison isn't progressing as fast as what I want. He's still progressing, doing well. And then Aquino's actually doing pretty good. You see here, he's at 75 overall now, so I actually want to keep him down there because he's progressing really well. I don't want to stunt his growth, and I'm actually thinking about not trading him anymore, because though at the rate he's progressing, I mean, he's going to be high 70s come next season, and that's going to be a pretty good asset to have in our outfield, and he might start next year. I mean, he has the ability to start. And Aquino, like I said, we moved him up last year, and it stunted his growth. And one guy they did want for Munoz is James Nelson, and James Nelson is actually one of the guys that I was hoping to keep around. But I think Munoz is just too good to pass on here. He's 24 years old, and he has good attributes all around the board. So we're actually going to make this trade. James Nelson is having kind of a down year. It says he has the flame right now, but it's because he started so slow, and now he's kind of hot now. So he didn't make the All-Star game or anything, and I mean, I don't think I'm going to miss him much, mainly because Lucas Salee is there at third base. And you know what? Lucas Salee can possibly be our future at first base as well. We'll have to see, because he can play first base as a secondary position. And I don't think he's going to be a middle infielder at all. I think he is a corner infielder. So I'm actually going to make this trade. James Nelson, they do get younger. They get a 21-year-old at C potential. Let's just see what they have at third base. So I do see why they do want him. He would be their top third base prospect. And that's behind Tim Beckham. Tim Beckham's actually pretty decent. I mean, he's probably an average major leaguer. This year, he's actually hitting 296, which is pretty good. But looking to the future, I mean, they don't really have anybody at third base. So Tim Beckham's actually going to be a free agent too. So who knows? James Nelson, I mean, he's right now, he might be slated to be their starter next season. We'll see. So I'm actually going to make this trade. And let's see, they do accept it. And since, you know, Munoz does have MLB experience, I'm going to move him up right away, and he's already on the roster. See, there he is. So I'm actually going to give him the start, because he did hit 280 last year, and he's on a hot streak. So you see that he was actually hitting close to 300 at the AAA level. They had him at the AAA level. So I actually like what he's doing. I like how he's progressing. So I'm going to give him the start right away. And like I said, he's already been boosted. Look at this. He's went up 2 overall right now. And probably once I put him in the lineup, he's going to boost up even more. So let's put him in the lineup and then hop into this action. Like I said, we're going into a crucial series, a 4-game series versus the Washington Nationals. Let's just see where we're at in the standings. So if you look at the Nationals, they won one game. They're 2.5 games back. The Mets are also 2.5 games back. So we're actually in first place right now. We're in a good place, but we are 4-6 in our last 10. So we do have to prove on that. But what did help us out, the Nationals, they went 1-9. So let's hop into this 4-game series right before All-Star break. You don't want to miss any of this, because we got Munoz, the new acquisition, coming into the lineup, and we'll see how he does. So let's get into it. Let's go. Anthony DeSclafani actually is having a pretty good year, 1.17 whip. And speaking of like the rest of our pitchers, I mean, our pitching is carrying us, and all of our starting pitchers have a whip of under 1.30 at this point of the season. I mean, our starting rotation, it's funny because I might want to keep this rotation in the future. I mean, a lot of these guys I don't want to let go in free agency come next year. I mean, Marco Estrada's doing good. DeSclafani's doing good. Urania is actually doing good. And all these guys are pretty much surprising me up to this point. And it's been a pretty good surprise, because, you know, the guy that we thought would dominate, Machado, he's just doing okay. So here's Munoz here for his first at bat as a Marlin with a runner in scoring position, and he is going to drive in a run with his first at bat. So that makes it a 1-0 game going up against Max Scherzer. And Leury Garcia comes up with one out. He's starting in center field this game for Brinson, giving him the day off. And the left fielder dives and gets that one. But JT Realmuto on his horse gets in to score. So this is a 2-0 game here in the second inning as our offense is finally getting some runs early in the game as Starlin Castro comes up to the plate. And he gets a hit to the right side. So here comes Domingo Santana up with one out. And he hits one past the first baseman that time. That one's going to sneak through. And Castro is going to make it to second. So guys on first and third here. One out as Machado draws a walk. So now bases loaded as the pitching coach has to come out. And Adrian Beltre comes to the plate. 3-2 count with one out. Hitting a blooper to right field. And that's going to be another diving catch by another Washington National outfielder, but we're going to get three runs here in the first three innings, which is pretty good because, I mean, like I said, we haven't been producing many runs. Hopefully Munoz gives us that little boost we need to maybe get some more runs. So here in the fifth inning, giving up a hit down the line to Tommy Pham. And remember, the Nationals traded for Tommy Pham, and I wasn't even thinking about it, but he's a really good player. I mean, he hits... His hitting zones are all red. I mean, he's a good average hitter. He hits for good average. And I think that he might make it difficult for us to win this division because Washington has the pieces. They have the pieces. Even though they lost Bryce Harper, they still have the pieces. And I think they're just putting it together as they go. They're not going into that rebuilding phase like a lot of teams do when they lose their superstars. But it seems like they just keep replenishing. So now on to the top of the seventh inning, Anthony DeSclafani comes to the plate, and he helps himself out at the plate, getting the hit up the middle. So Justin Bour comes up and kind of acts like a bunt, hits a little dribbler back to the catcher, and that one's going to be out at first. So now man on second here, two outs in the seventh inning. Domingo Santana, who's actually taken a little step back, gets a big pitch to hit, and he hits a liner to the right center gap, and another run comes in to score here in the seventh inning. So we take the 4-1 lead, and Machado comes up, but they do intentionally walk him. So they do face Adrian Beltre one more time, and he gets an inside slider, but he's going to inside out that pitch to right field, and that's going to be an out going in to the bottom of the seventh inning where Brian Dozier, remember they signed Brian Dozier, so they replaced Bryce Harper with Brian Dozier, then brought in Tommy Pham, and look who comes up next. Zimmerman takes this pitch over the left field wall. DeSclafani was doing good up to this point, not giving up a lot of runs, only one run up to this point, but Zimmerman takes advantage of the high pitch that time, takes it out of the park. So now we do get two outs in this inning, still with DeSclafani on the mound, and we do get a ground out up the middle. So now onto the top of the ninth inning here, and our offense is still going here as Starlin Castro hits a liner to the right fielder, and not this time, another diving catch. So Starlin Castro rounds second, heads to third, and he's in the third with a stand-up double here with one out in the inning, and you know who's coming up next. Justin Bour, and he's been hot lately. He hits one deep, a pitch right down the middle, but that one's going to stay in the yard. But luckily, one out in the inning. It's deep enough to get the runner in easily as we take the two-run lead here. Going into the bottom of the ninth inning, Bartolo Colon in for the save. And uh-oh, I mean, this is a problem that Bartolo Colon's been facing in the early parts of the season. He's kind of overcome it as of late, but here he's facing Tommy Pham. I just got done saying how he's an overall great hitter. He hits one off the wall, and look at Leury Garcia, does not field the ball off the wall and allows Tommy Pham to come all the way across the plate as the runner slides in safe, and JT Realmuto could not handle that one. So now we do get it to two outs as Defoe strikes out, but what a way to end the first nine innings of the game with that play. But in the top of the 12th inning, Justin Bour comes up to the plate, and like I said, he's been hot. He gets a pitch to groove to deep right field. That one's not coming back as Justin Bour continues to, you know, allow his average to rise. Remember, he was down there with Realmuto, but he's turned things around, and we do get Danny Barnes in to pitch in the bottom of the 12th, and we finally get out of this game without using too many pitchers, but we do get 13 hits. That you would think that's enough to win it in 9 innings, but we had to win it in 12. So now on to this is actually the last game of the series. I actually lost the content of the previous two games. I don't know what happened to it. I just had quick highlights, but I lost it. So now we're on to the fourth game in the series. Now Washington actually went and stole the last two games. So now we're down 1-2 in this series as we try to get a win going into All-Star break and splitting the series versus the Nationals going in All-Star break. As we give up a home run, Michael Fulmer doesn't give up many, but he gives up one to Anthony Rendon here into the bullpen. And that is going to be a 1-0 lead for the Washington Nationals. But Justin Bour continues to hit the ball well as he just straight hits a missile into left center field and away from the shift over the fence as Justin Bour ties this game up that fast. So Tanner Roark is actually starting for the Washington Nationals in this game, and he actually pitched pretty good. I didn't get many hits off of him. As you can see in the fifth inning, we just cannot get hits this game as Adrian Beltre pops out to right field and JT Realmuto comes up with two outs and he pops one out to right field. So Tanner Roark is actually just pitching quite a gem this game. So now on to the top of the sixth inning. And here is Adrian Beltre drawing the walk. That one probably could have been a strike on that one. And JT Realmuto comes up next, and he hits one to right center. And that one's going to drop down as Adrian Beltre with that 19 speed does make it to third base on that one. So now we bring in Leury García, who got – remember, he got relegated to the bench as we made room for Munoz in the lineup because Leury García has been struggling. But he hits a pop-up to left field, and we're actually going to try to tag up with that 19 speed, and Beltre does get in. That is deep enough to score the runner that time. So now one out in this inning still. Domingo Santana comes to the plate, and he hits one up the middle. This is actually into the ninth inning, and we start this inning out with a hit up the middle. Domingo Santana is actually a guy I thought that would hit for about 320 this season. He's only hitting about 280, 285, something like that. And he's kind of struggling a little bit. But who's not struggling? Justin Bour, as he drives one to the left center gap. But Machado hits a late jump going to third base, and he gets thrown out. So two outs in this inning. Munoz actually comes up, but that one's going to be in the infield, and that is going to be an out at first base. But now we move on to the bottom of the ninth inning as Drew Steckenrider, continuing this magical season, gives up a hit to left side. Not again. Remember, the last game, same exact scenario, but we do get Brian Dozier to ground out into a double play to end this one, and we split the series going into All-Star break as our offense, another cold game. Four hits, we score three runs off of four hits, and luckily we have Justin Bour and his power, because without that, we probably would have lost this game, but we do come out with a win. Michael Fulmer moves on to be 9-4 going into the All-Star break. So what a season he's had up to this point. Six strikeouts through seven innings, giving up four hits, pretty good. One earned run, one walk. He's having a pretty good season. I wonder if he's going to make the All-Star game. I guess we'll have to see. So Drew Steckenrider gets his first save of the season. I kind of was pitching him in the setup role. He pitched two innings, and he did the job. So we're going into All-Star break. Hit subscribe, hit that like button, because I'm interested to see who's going to be in the All-Star game for us. I don't really know yet, so let's just see. So tune in. Let's go.